know, I don't have anything to do this afternoon except for drive about 8.5 hours down to Fort Myers, so we can go to like 3 o'clock, you know. But, when I was in Romania several years ago, a professor asked me, the general superintendent asked me to share in his church. And what I didn't, he said, share for a few minutes. And so being a good missionary, that's what I did, was shared for a few minutes. And of course, I used an interpreter. And as I was walking back after just a couple of minutes, everybody was looking at me kind of strange. Well, his idea of a few minutes was like 15 to 20 minutes of preaching, you know. And there they actually have like 3 sermons in a service. You know, so it was, that's why I always like to know what time, everything else, you know. But it is indeed a pleasure to be here today. I am with the American Indian College in Phoenix, Arizona. I'm one of those people that I truly love what God has called me to do. I can't wait to get to work in the morning. I'm usually the first one there. I kind of usually, a lot of times, I greet the cleaning crew. And I'm also one of the last ones to leave, and just because I have a lot of stuff that I'm doing. Like I said, I teach Bible theology, I teach leadership classes, I teach evangelism, I'm the department chair, and I'm studying for my doctorate. So I keep kind of busy, and it keeps me on my toes. But I love teaching. That's what God has called me to do. I pastored 3 churches in the past and was on staff in 3 churches. One of those was a church plant in Illinois, and but God called me to teach, and teachers will understand this, is that the reason that we teach is to see the light come on. When students don't understand something, then all of the sudden, you can literally see it in their eyes. And it's wonderful to see that. Sometimes it happens in a classroom. Sometimes it happens in a tutorial session. But you can see it. You know when it's happened. And they understand it. And we have a lot of Native Americans. Of course, we're American Indian College. We have about 95 students. About half of those are Native American. They come from 15 to 20 different tribes. Our biggest are Navajo and Apache. And but our students aren't really some of them aren't typical college students. Some of them come with what we call academic challenges, and they have to test to when they test to come into the college, and sometimes they have to take college prep classes. And even though when they finish those, we still have to spend a lot of time with them tutoring and getting them up to speed. I actually take pride in this. I'm the toughest professor on campus, and I give the least amount of A's. I don't consider it an A as something that you get. It's something that you earn. And I'm also the grammar police. I believe that you should be able to read and write a sentence and form a paragraph in coherent terms, you know. And the first couple of years I was there, I graded on hard copy and a red pen. And a couple of students, who actually 2 of my better students, I even marked up their papers. And they were leaving the class after getting their research paper back. And one of them said, "Well, let me see your paper." And he started looking at it. And he said, "Man," he says, "it looked like he sacrificed a goat on it, you know." Says, "You've been Cloused, you know." So like during commencement services, I get a lot of red pen comments about Professor Klaus used the red pen. But I do that because I want to see the students excel. And many of them, it takes a lot of time to spend with them. We're not your typical professors where we just go in and lecture and that's it. We often have students lined up outside our doors just for tutoring and stuff along like that. But I want to show you a video here in a minute that kind of gives you an idea of what the baggage that some of the students bring to the college with them. And I want to emphasize that some, not all of them, but many of them come with backgrounds that we're not too familiar with, that most of the people aren't familiar with. And it has a lot to do with their struggles in their personal lives. So if we could go ahead and just show that video. It's about 3 minutes long. And pay attention to some of the statistics, not just because there's a good-looking guy on it, but if we could go ahead and show that.
I've traveled extensively throughout the United States and into 18 foreign countries. I've traveled as a pastor, as a missionary, as a member of the armed forces, and as a Peace Corps volunteer. I have seen great needs throughout the world. However, some of the greatest needs of overcoming poverty, oppression, and the lack of spiritual awareness can be seen right here in our own country. Of the 4 million Native Americans from the 561 tribes in the United States, over 93% of them are unevangelized. Only 7% know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. There are over 90,000 Native Americans that are homeless. Of those who do own homes, 30% of them are tremendously overcrowded. 50% of them do not have access to public sewer systems. American Indian reservations often contain the poorest counties in the state. While 40% of the Native Americans are under the age of 20, 1 in 4 of them will become a drug addict or an alcoholic by the time they're 17 years old. Less than 50% will graduate from high school, and only 3% have an earned college degree. The suicide rate amongst Native Americans is 4 times the national average. The American Indian College in Phoenix, Arizona is currently celebrating its 50th year of ministry to Native Americans. It is the only Bible college for American Indians that is accredited in the United States. Our greatest desire is to raise up indigenous students to be pastors, missionaries, and evangelists to the American Indians so that they one day might know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. With your help, we can go to the American Indian College. Would you stand by us? Will you help us to raise up leaders for tomorrow and for today to reach the Native American people with the gospel of Jesus Christ?
Now I've seen love make heaven ring. Where the secret rivers meet beneath the shadow. I see the sky about to rain, and I hear the prairies calling out your name.
This is a DVD that we did when I first started itinerating, so we're now starting our 58th year. And as I say, our focus is on Native Americans, and they come with all kinds of problems, many of them. But we work hard to minister to them, to educate them, and I'm happy to say that we are quite successful in that. There is about, I think, 35 Native American colleges in the United States. We are the only one that is regionally accredited and as a Christian college. We do also have another sister college up in the Carolinas, but it doesn't have the same accreditation. All the rest of them are run by the federal government. We have the distinction of having the highest retention rate and the highest graduation rate of all of the Native American colleges in the United States. So we work hard with our students. 94% of our elementary education students pass the Arizona board exams, which is about the same rate as Arizona State University, which is the largest university in the United States. about 95%, I think 95% of our ministry students are involved in some form of ministry. About 80% of our associate's degrees in business are involved in some form of business. You know, so a lot of our students, though, get double degrees, and they might have an associate's degree in business and a bachelor's in ministry, or associates in a ministry and a bachelor's in education. And the reason that they do that is because they're going to do ministry on the reservation. The average pastor nationwide, the average pastor on an American Indian reservation gets paid $2,500 a year. So they have to have another form of employment to be able to do the ministry that they want to do. Some of them say that, well, they have to have this a secular job to support their ministry habit, you know. So, but our students are doing great. About 11% of our students go on for master's and doctorate degrees, which doesn't sound like a lot, but according to what you saw in the video was that only 50% graduate from high school and only 3% get a earned bachelor's degree. You know, 11% is pretty good. You know, so they're going on, and many of them are serving in their churches or in education and just doing tremendous jobs. Our goal is that what we desire as individuals at the college is that we want to be replaced by Native Americans. You know, and we are now in the process of, while in the past it wasn't considered important to the Native American community to get a bachelor's degree, it's becoming more and more important, but now we're starting to push for the master's. And we want those students to come back to take our places. And we have one young lady who's from Louisiana that makes a mean batch of gumbo. And she's from the Chihuta tribe, and come to my office, and she came to us from one of the state universities in Louisiana, and she was there to strictly play basketball, and her grades showed that. But when she came to AIC, she had really close to a perfect 4.0, and a very driven, intelligent young lady. And I was talking to her, and one day I says, you know, you should really consider a master's degree. And she kind of like, no. Nobody had ever talked to her about the possibility of a master's degree. And I said, you know, you have the personality, you have the intelligence, you have the drive, you can do this. And so myself and another professor, we talked with her about it for quite some time. And finally, one day she came into my office. She said, you know, she said, I've really been thinking about this master's degree, and I think I would like to do it. I said, well, as long as you can do it, you know, if you can afford to do it, go ahead. And she happens to be one of the very rare people, the Native Americans, and that her tribe, she comes from a tribe that has some money. And we here in Florida, we look at Seminoles and stuff like that, and they have all the casinos. Well, most tribes don't have that kind of stuff. And most of them are very poor tribes. And she said, well, I can afford it. I said, well, how's that? She says, well, my tribe pays for everything. I get room and board, I get tuition and a stipend and for living expenses. And I said, well, how long will they do that? She says, for as long as I'm in college. I said, good, now we're talking about a PhD. And that kind of freaked her out there too, but she is now attending Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary for a Master's of Divinity, which is, for those of you who don't know, is a very prestigious seminary. And she's going to go get her Master's of Divinity there and then go for her PhD in Biblical Languages. And I asked her, I said, well, which one are you going to specialize in? Because it's either Greek or Hebrew. And she said, Hebrew. I said, why that? She says, because I find that it's similar to my native tongue. And I thought, I had never heard of that before. And so I went online, I did some research, and there's some scientific research out there proving that the Native American languages are similar in base to the ancient Hebrew. So she's going to be specializing in that. And my goal is that someday when she comes that she will come back to the college and take my place when I retire. You know, and that's going to be a few years down the road. I don't know when, but I plan on teaching as long as I'm mentally able to do so. And I say that because there was a professor in seminary that should have retired before he did. But and hopefully I have friends who will say, Ron, it's time to leave. And but we have students like that that are special. And yes, we do have our pets. We do spend special time with some of the students. And by the way, I told her when she said she wanted to do her master's degree, I said, now I'm going to hold you to a higher accountability. And I want you to go to every one of your professors and ask them to do the same thing. She said, no. I said, well, if you don't, I will. So she went to each one of her professors and said, I want to go for a master's degree. I want you to push me harder. And so we have to get her ready for master's level work, you know. So, and we have several students like that. We have them that are going on there for their doctorate. They're now part of our board. And we have pastors that we've brought on, Native American pastors that are alumni of the college that now sit on our board of regents. And we made an honest attempt several years ago. We disinvited some members of our board of regents and replaced them with Native American leaders because we are an American Indian college and they weren't showing up most of the time anyway. You know, so our goal is to be replaced by Native Americans. We have a young man who's an alumni of our college. His father is a former president and got his bachelor's degree with us, was in the Army, was a tank commander in the Middle East, came back after serving there, and got his master's degree, is now working on his PhD, is now a professor there. He's an adjunct professor teaching one class. Our goal is to bring him on full-time at some point, whenever we can, but everybody's goal is that one day he becomes the president of the college. You know, so we want it to be Native American college because we practice a principle of reaching indigenous people to lead indigenous people. You know, so that's what our goal is. And pray for us that happens. We're in the process of transforming and we're loving what we see is happening. The hardest part is getting Native Americans, once they get their master's or their doctorate, to come because we can't pay them that much and they can make a whole lot more money somewhere else because it's prestigious to have a Native American with a doctorate at any university. So pray that God gives them the vision to come be with us. If you have any questions, please feel free after the service. Meet me back at the table or ask me any kind of questions. There isn't any question I haven't heard before. Once in a while I get surprised and stumped, but usually I have an answer for it. But one of the favorite classes that I teach is my evangelism class. It is a freshman level class that every student has to take. And I do things a little different. I've been teaching for 5 years now. We work with a local church. It happens to be an inner city church where my wife and I attend. It's fairly close to the college. And I do a little different because I don't believe that you can learn evangelism in a classroom. So it's a 2-hour class, which means we meet for 2 days a week for 1 hour. But what I do, and I've been doing this, like I said, for 5 years, is that the first 2 weeks, I just do impromptu situations where I just stick students into situations. And sometimes I don't even know what it's going to be until they get up there. And what it is, it's training because after the 2 weeks of that, what we do is we switch to a 1-day-a-week academic class, and we go out on Saturday mornings. We go door-to-door. And last semester, we had 15 salvations. And we've worked with the same church now for 3 years, and people are starting to come to that church because of the outreaches. And it's a wonderful thing to see. But one young lady a couple of years ago, she came up to me after class. She says, she said, I really enjoy doing these. She said, but it would be nice to know ahead of time what we're going to do. And I looked at her and I kind of smiled. I said, you're missing the main point. And she kind of looked at me, why? I said, because you don't know any situation that you're going to be, when you knock on that door, you have no idea what it's going to be. And she goes, oh. You know, so I want to encourage you today to do what God has called you to do. And that's to do the work of an evangelist. And if you would, if you'd open your Bibles to John chapter 14. I want to look today at Jesus' encounter with a Samaritan woman at the well. And you're probably going to think, well, I've read this before. What does this have to do with reaching people with the gospel? It has everything to do because it is a format that we can use to reach people. It's Jesus showing us how we can do it. And there are several things you need to know before we really get into this. And the one thing is that there is a theme that flows through this whole chapter. The theme flows with a Samaritan woman, and it also flows with the disciples after the Samaritan woman leaves. And that theme is that there is a physical and a spiritual theme that runs through this. And this is what happens also when we deal with people who aren't saved. Because they're thinking physical and you're thinking spiritual, and that's perfectly all right. That's just the way it is. Your goal, though, is to get them to start thinking along spiritual lines. So we look here at Jesus and the woman at the well, and there's going to be some cultural things that you have to understand that are going on here, and we'll go through these in probably pretty much verse by verse. If we look at these things, and we have to understand people's cultures. One of the biggest problems that we have in American society is not addressing cultural issues. If you want to get to learn to know someone, you have to understand their culture. And a good example of this is my wife and I. Now, we've been married 33 years. We dated on and off for 5 years. When I first saw her, I was president of a Catholic singles club, and she walked in the door late. Should have been a sign, but some people understand that, some get it, some don't. But she's from New York City, from the Bronx. I'm originally from a farm in Ohio. You don't get much different than that. You know, I have the rural in me, she has the city in her. I still want to live on a farm. I'm jealous of my brother. He just bought a couple of acres, renovated the house. He's got a little garden. He's got gardens going on and cattle and chickens, and I'm jealous of that. You know, she could care less. But we were out on a date one time, and she said something, and I asked her to repeat it. And so she did, and I said, how do you spell that? Because I couldn't understand what she was saying, because she had this Bronx accent. She'd only been out of the Bronx about a year. You know, but I have to understand her culture from where she came from. And she has to understand mine. And we've done pretty good over 33 years. But we have other things, other issues in our own culture when we meet people. And, you know, I've traveled. I've been in like 17 foreign countries. I've been in all 50 states. And I love to travel. But one of the things that I use, especially when I go overseas, is I will sit down with someone and I will ask them about their culture. And I would just say, hey, I'm from the United States. I don't know anything about your culture. Tell me something. And you'll be surprised how quickly you become friends because you show an interest in them. And I've done this in every country that I can think of. And it works tremendously. And eventually they're going to get around and ask you about your culture, about America, and you can kind of blow away the myth that all of us live in Hollywood, that we all have big expensive houses and drive big expensive cars, and we got a bank account that's just unbelievable. Because most people in Europe, in that, all they see is the Hollywood stuff. You know, so it's interesting to get to know other people's culture. And what we want to look at here, we want to start here in verse 4. He says, now he had to go through Samaria, So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near to the plot of ground Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about the sixth hour. In Jewish time frame, the sixth hour is noon, because their day starts at 6 o'clock in the morning, okay? So it's important to know that, because it has to deal with everything. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" And his disciples had gone into town to buy food. That sounds like a pretty simple request, isn't it? A lot of times when we go to someone's house, we're offered something to drink. You know, maybe if you're going to be there longer, you're going to get offered something to eat. But so he asked her, "Give me a drink." Doesn't sound like much, but you have to understand the culture. And the culture in their time was this, was that the women went to the well every morning and every afternoon to draw the water that they needed for their household. The well was deep. The well is still there today. It's, I think, around 140 feet deep. So you have to have a rope, you have to have a bucket to draw the water out. Okay? Men wouldn't have these things because it was a woman's job to do that. So it would be a very common thing for Jesus to ask her, "Can you give me a drink?" And everything has fallen apart. So that's the first one that we look at. Now we get down here and we let's continue on. As soon as I get back here to beans, my marker just fell out. We have to understand the cultures and the reason why Jesus is there. Okay. Sorry about that. And a Samaritan woman said to him, "You are the Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Another thing that we have to understand is the relationship between Samaritans and Jews. If you look through the gospel, Jesus often refers to Samaritans. The relationship they have goes back to the time of the Exodus. During the Exodus, it was the upper class and middle class that were exported to taken away, okay? And they stayed there for roughly 70 years. And it was the lower class people that stayed behind to till the land, stuff along like that. Well, those that stayed behind intermarried with other cultures and religions and became known eventually as the Samaritans. They considered themselves to be the chosen people of God because they did not have to go through the Exodus. However, the Jews that came back considered themselves to be the chosen people of God because they had gone through the Exodus. And this is something that has been going on at this point for about 500 years. And it's gotten to the point where even though the trade route through Samaria was the shortest route, is that many of the merchants would not even go through there because they didn't want to get their animals defiled. They considered the Samaritans lower than dogs. They had no respect for them. There was this great animosity. But you look here and she says, "You know, you're a Jew. You know, why are you even talking to me?" The other aspect of this is that it was the custom in those days that Jewish men did not talk to women that they were not related to. So she's looking at him saying, "You're a Jew, you're a man, you're not related to me. Why are you even talking to me?" So we understand all of this. And she's curious about this. And she's kind of like, "Why? What is going on?" Don't you love how Jesus breaks man's customs? Because this is man's customs. This isn't God's. It's man's. Jesus says that none of that is important. And that's kind of the thing that we have to do in our own society. We need to break man's customs. We need to break man's laws so that we can reach everybody with the gospel of Christ. We sang a song earlier. It's for everybody, isn't it? It isn't just for the select, chosen, frozen. You know, No, it's not for the blessed, it's for no more. It's for everybody. Jesus loves everybody. And he's proven it here at this at Jacob's well. So, and Jesus answered her. I love how Jesus answers. And you notice this is going physical and spiritual. He says, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. We have to ask ourselves the question, what does living water mean? Because they're at a well, aren't they? You know, they're there and they're talking, she's talking about the physical water. Jesus all of a sudden brings in the spiritual water. Well, another thing that we have to understand is this, is that throughout the Old and New Testament, whenever it refers to water that you drink, it always refers to the Holy Spirit. When it refers to water that you wash with, it refers to God's Word. So what is Jesus saying here? Jesus says, here, if you want to substitute words, he said he would have given you the Holy Spirit. Sir, the woman said, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us his well and drank for him himself, as did also his sons, his flocks, and his herds? This is what you call sarcasm. By the way, I am the king of sarcasm. I think sarcasm should be a font. I would use it all the time. You know, I even have we give each other names at our professors give each other's names. Mine is the King of Chaos. I have a sign on my door that says King of Chaos, right below all my other stuff, you know. And I don't know why they did that, just because usually at the end of the spring semester, I'm the one who buys all the squirt guns for the students. But here she is, she's really mocking him. And we kind of sometimes do this today, too. You ever have someone who's trying to tell you something? Maybe it's a younger person, and maybe it's a... Well, there's no teenagers in here, so, you know, everybody... teenagers think that everybody who's older doesn't know anything. And they are right when it comes to computers, because I always have someone younger fixing my computer. But it's kind of like, you know, you don't want to hear it, so you kind of... Maybe you think of it, maybe you even say it, and you come up with this expression like, who do you think you are? You're telling me what to do? Right? Y'all ever done that? Yeah, all of us have done that, haven't we? Yeah, I've done it once or twice myself. And Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. I'm one of those people that I'm an optimist. I believe not only that the glass is half full, but it has a potential to overflow. Okay? And I believe that God is saying to his church today, I want you to have the potential to overflow. Springing up into eternal life. What God wants us to do is that he wants his church to affect the lives of other people. Having a relationship with Christ is not just a personal thing. It is a corporate thing. It is a world-changing thing. It is that we are called here to teach and reach other people with the gospel of Christ. We need to affect the lives of non-believers. Do you understand that? That's what God has called us to do. To affect lives. To be world changers. So that the gospel of Christ can go forward. That's what he wants us for. That's why God saved us. We're not saved just to sit on a pew. We're not saved to get goosebumps. We're saved to reach people with the gospel of Christ. We are saved to evangelize and disciple. That's what's the biggest thing that I see missing in the American church today is the evangelism and the discipleship. And by the way, they have to go hand in hand. One without the other. If you just evangelize, all you have is a bunch of baby Christians that eventually fall away. And if you just disciple, you don't have, after a while, you don't have anybody to disciple. They've been discipled already. So you have to have evangelism and discipleship. They have to go hand in hand. And that's what God has called us to do. Verse 15, the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." Why would she say that? Why wouldn't she want to come? Remember, though, that the custom of the time was that the women went to the well in the morning and in the evening, but this woman is there at noon. Why is that? Why is she alone? We know women never go anywhere alone. You know, it's always like, "I'm going to the bathroom. You want to go with me?" Did you ever hear a guy say that? Never. You know, "I'm going to do this. You want to go with me?" Guys are like, "See, I'll be back later." You know, and unless it's like Home Depot, then you bring your buddies if you can, you know, because that's our toy store, you know. And but she's here alone. Why is that? Let's look at this. And she says, Jesus says to her, Go call your husband and come back. What does that have to do with water? Living water or physical water, it has nothing to do with it. But there are times when you're ministering to people that the Holy Spirit will give us a word of knowledge or a word of wisdom. And my advice to you is that you just go ahead and speak it. Because it's not about you, it's about Jesus. It's about Jesus speaking into the lives of people. Okay? He says, "Go call your husband and come back." She says, "I have no husband." Jesus says, "You're right when you say you've had no husband. The fact is that you've had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have said is quite true." You want to know why she was there at 12 o'clock? See, not only was she a Samaritan, an outcast of Jewish society, she was an outcast of her own society. Nobody wanted to hang around with her. How many of you ladies want to hang around with a woman who's been married five times and is now living with someone she's not married to? Any takers? I had one lady one time raise her hand. And I was shocked. I said, "Why?" She says, "Because I was that woman." And everybody in church, I think a lot of them didn't know that. But I think it took guts for her to admit that that was her, that described her. But you look at it and say, you know, there's times and people like that that we wouldn't even want to talk to them. But Jesus is there. And think about where he is. Not only is he talking to a Samaritan woman, he's in Samaria as a Jewish rabbi talking with a Samaritan woman who's been married five times and is now living with a man she's not married to. The guy probably thought, you know, the last five husbands, they died or whatever, so I'm not taking that chance. I don't know, you know. But he didn't care because he loves her. And notice how now her thoughts start to change. Well, she's going to start asking spiritual questions because Jesus has spoken into her life. She says, "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet." Now, I don't think anybody's going to tell you that. Because most people nowadays have no idea what a true prophet is anyway. But they might say, "How did you know that?" And it's a golden opportunity to start speaking into their lives about how much Jesus loves them, that regardless of their past, he still died on the cross for their sins. That's what it's all about. Says, "Our fathers worship on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where you must worship is in Jerusalem." I love Jesus' his reply here. Jesus declared, "Believe me, woman, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth." Jesus uses this phrase twice for emphasis, that we are to worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Now, we have to look at that. If Jesus mentions it twice, it must be important. So what does it mean to worship God in spirit and in truth? Basically, what it means is that we are to worship God under his terms and not ours. You know, sometimes you come in here, and we're just going to use this as an example, because in church is not the only time you worship God, okay? Sometimes you come in here and everything is going good, and it's easy, really easy, to get involved in praise and worship, isn't it? And there's other times when you come in here and you just don't feel it. Guess which time is more important? Both of them. Sometimes it's hard to worship, isn't it? Maybe you had a fight with the kids, or your spouse, or somebody cut you off. When I was driving down here this morning, the lady in front of me, she was speeding up, slowing down, running off the road. And I'm thinking, like, what is wrong with you? Yeah. You know, and those things would be easy to get upset about. I drive a lot. I think three or four times yesterday on I-75, people cut me off, you know, which I call, you know, like, passing too close. That aggravates me. I'm like, you know, but I just kind of like, okay, nothing happened. Just let it go. You know, did I feel like praising God then? No, I felt like running them off the road. Okay, just to be honest with you, you know. But we have to worship God under his terms. And sometimes we don't feel like it. There was one time, I hadn't been saved very long, and I really didn't know much about God's healing and stuff along that line. And I used to get migraine headaches. Okay, anybody here ever have a migraine? Okay, you'll understand this. Some people won't. But I tell people, if you've never had a migraine, you've never had a headache. Okay, mine would last for 4 and 5 days straight. And it hurt. My eyes hurt. And the music was, every sound was just unbelievable. Lights, just everything. I would literally sometimes throw up. I would come home from, I had a plastering business at the time. Try plastering with a migraine headache. Okay. And I didn't have the luxury of staying home because you run the crews and stuff. And I would come home from work, I'd pull all the shades, I'd turn the air conditioner way down, and I would literally lay on the couch and take the bottom of my hand and press on my eyeballs, because that was the only way I could get rid of the pain. And this would go on for 4 or 5 days. And then after that, you know, the day that actually, after it was gone, I felt like I was just so worn out. And I was sitting one Sunday morning in a service in my home church, in the church I got saved in, And I had one of these migraine headaches, and the music was too loud, the lights were too bright, and I thought to myself, I'm just going to go home. And God spoke to me. He says, I want you to praise me. And you know what I said? No, I don't feel like it. And God said, I want you to worship me. And it was like one of those audible voices in your head. So I thought, maybe there's something to this. So I really struggled through the first song. I didn't even raise my hands. Second song, third song, however many songs later, by the time it was all over, my headache was gone. I had no side effects, and I've never had another migraine since then. I believe, even though I was not asking for a healing, I believe that God honored that my obedience to what he was saying and healed me. And I praise God for that. You know, I rarely even have a headache anymore. I can't remember the last time I had a regular headache. But I praise God that now 30 years later, I don't have migraines. And I believe it was because I was being obedient to God. I wasn't asking for it. He just did it. So there's times that maybe, now I'm not saying this is definitely, maybe God's not working in your life because you're not being obedient to God somewhere. Did you ever think about that? Maybe God's dealing with you about something and things aren't going right because he's still trying to get your attention. And God wants you to be obedient to him and praise him and worship him under his terms and not our own terms. We look at these last two verses here, and the woman said, I know that the Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. Ever read this and really kind of let it impact you a little bit? Very simple wording that she uses. But do you understand what's behind it? Who is it that's saying this? This is a Samaritan. This is a woman who's had five husbands. You know, she's the type of person that maybe today she would be the lady of the night. Maybe she's a drug addict or an alcoholic that we would probably, if we saw her, we would want to go to the other side of the street. Okay? She would be the type of person that most of us really wouldn't want to hang around. She's the outcast of the outcast. But yet, she's looking for the Messiah. And you know, there's a lot of people that are looking for Christ. They just don't know how or where or why they need to find him. Think about your television shows. We are naturally a spiritual people. Look at the television shows. How many of them are spiritual in nature? A lot of them. 99% of them, though, are not worth watching. And the good ones usually don't last too long because they blow everything out of proportion. But people are looking for something spiritual, and guess what? We have the answer. I used to say we are the roadmap of the gospel, and we can show people how to go. Now I just say we're the GPS system. You know, you have to keep up with the technology. God love, I love GPSs, man. Except for I couldn't find this church on GPS. I had to go to Google Map on my phone. You know, but we are the ones that God has chosen to fill us with the Holy Spirit and lead others to Christ. It's not complicated, folks. It's not complicated at all. It's very simple. Keep the gospel simple. I love Jesus' response to her. Here she's saying, you know, that when he comes, he will reveal everything to us. And Jesus, look at his response. He says, and Jesus declared, I who speak to you am he. That would be like someone coming in here and walking through the front door now and saying, oh, I'd like to speak to Pastor Burka, okay? And he would raise up and say, hi, I'm Pastor Tom. How you doing? It's as simple as that. We need to introduce people to Jesus. And by the way, just as a side note here, there's only three times in the Gospels that Jesus distinctly, purposefully claims to be the Messiah, and this is one of those. The other two times is the first time it is at Caesarea Philippi, which is one of the most northern parts of Israel. You can't go much further than Caesarea Philippi and still be in Israel, okay? And he did so there because he was so far away, he knew that the word couldn't get back to Jerusalem, okay? And the reason that he did that was that he knew what the false messiahs, people who had claimed to be a messiah before him, that they were all executed, okay? And the Jews were famous for that, for killing false messiahs. And all the followers would be executed. Okay, so he wouldn't proclaim that right in Jerusalem. So, but he did claim it in Caesarea Philippi, and then he claims it in Samaria, and the third time he did it was at his trial. Now, there are a lot of other times where there's a reference, especially in the book of John, the I am references go back to the time of Moses in the burning bush, when Moses says, "Who shall I say has sent me?" And God says, "I am that I am." Okay, it's the same word in the Hebrew and in the Greek. Okay, and so that's why they were so upset and tearing their clothes, because Jesus is indirectly claiming to be God. Okay, so they got really upset about that. But who is Jesus in your life? That's my question. Who is Jesus in your life? And how much of an impact do you want him to have in your life? And he often calls during services on the phone. So I love picking on people. I am an equal opportunity picker-onner. I tell all my students that. I'm an equal opportunity picker-onner. If I haven't picked on you yet, don't worry, I will get to you eventually. You know? But how much of an impact do you want Jesus to have in your life? Have you ever wondered, what's God's will for my life? We won't get into it a whole lot, except for the next part of this chapter is when the disciples come back. The woman leaves and goes to her town, to her village, and tells them, "I have met the man who's told me everything about my whole life, and you have to come meet him." Okay? And the disciples come back, and they're talking about food, because they had gone into town to buy lunch, and Jesus tells them this simple phrase. I think it's in verse... let me see here. Where are we at? Verse 21. No, that's not it. No, I can't pick it up. They come back. Here it is. In verse 34, it says, "My food..." Because they're talking about the disciples and who could have brought him food. "And my food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." If that's God's will for Jesus, isn't that God's will for us? What is God's will? Jesus proclaimed the gospel. That's what we're called to do. That's the number one priority of the church. It's not the preaching. It's not the teaching. It's not the worship. It's none of those things. The number one priority of the church is what happens outside of these walls. You know, we come in here to be filled, to take it outside and empty ourselves, to come back in and get filled up again. It says, "Do you not say 4 months more and then comes the harvest?" So this must have been in the springtime that Jesus was there with the woman at the well. And he says, "I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now the reaper draws his wages." What does it mean to be ripe for the harvest? It's an agricultural term. What it is, it's a reference to the grains of wheat, that they are so ripe that if not picked within the next couple of days, they will fall to the ground and rot. So the local church needs to look upon the fields that surround the church. And Jesus tells us that they are ripe for the harvest. That's what we're all about. That's what Jesus wants to do in our lives. He wants to fill us up with the anointing of his Spirit. He wants us to overcome. He wants us to be obedient. He wants us to share the gospel with those who do not believe. That's what it's all about, folks. That's why we're here. We're not here just to attend church. We're not here to get goosebumps. We are here to fulfill God's will, that the gospel would be proclaimed throughout our neighborhoods, our regions, our states, our nations, and our world. One of the last things Jesus told his disciples was he gave them the Great Commission. says, go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the othermost parts of the earth. And do what? To make disciples. To baptize and make disciples. The smallest but most important word that Jesus spoke in that whole sentence was the word go. Because without going, we can never leave the comfort zone. Without going somewhere, we can never tell people about Jesus. Without going, we can never be used by God to our fullest potential. Which means sometimes we have to get up and get out of our comfort zone to get into other cultures. To speak to people that we are uncomfortable with speaking to. And telling people about Jesus. You know, when I was in New Orleans, I taught at the School of Urban Ministry. And it was basically an inner city Bible college. And after Katrina, that campus closed down. And now it's in Oakland, California. But our students had no problem speaking with drug addicts, alcoholics, the down and out, the homeless, you know, people like that, because they had all come from backgrounds like that. The number one type of a person that they had a problem with was anybody in a business suit or a tie. They didn't know how to witness to people who were different from them. So what I would do is I would force them to do it. I just say, there's a person you're going to go talk to them. What? Oh, no. Yeah, go and do it. And so they had to get outside of their comfort zones. And guess what happened? They started becoming more comfortable with what they were doing. We have students that when they go out into the inner city that surrounds our campus, we're kind of like a oasis in a jungle. And I know that's kind of a weird term, but we have a very beautiful campus in a neighborhood that's not so good. And we have nice rolling hills, and we got a prayer mountain, and we got green grass, which is unusual in Arizona. But when they go out into our local neighborhood, when we're doing our outreaches with our local church there, they're very uncomfortable, some of them, because they've never been in that situation. The ones that come from the reservations, it's not a big deal to them. But one of the girls even used a false name because she didn't want anybody knowing what her real name was. And that was fine, so that was our nickname for her for the rest of the semester. And only people in the class got it, but, you know, that was okay. But get out of your comfort zone. See, I believe that God allows us to be comfortable for a while, then he stretches us and allows us to be comfortable. Then he stretches us some more, and he allows us to be comfortable and stretches us some more. And then this is a lifelong event that God keeps doing in our lives. So I encourage you to look and see, what is God's will for your life? The spreading of the gospel. How does God want you to do that? That's between you and God. You know, he's not calling you to the American Indians. That's my job, you know, and a few others. But he is calling you to your family, to your neighbors, to your town. And that's what God wants to do. He wants to pour out that living water in your life, so that he can be glorified and praised. Thank you so much. May God bless you.
Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for this compelling word that encourages us to reach beyond these walls to impact the lives of the people that you put in our path. And I want to ask you to do that more and more through our lives. America, the world needs Jesus. And you've left us, and we are in this world for that purpose, to be lights in a dark world, and to be the salt of the earth, and to be the voice of heaven to people who are dead in trespasses and sin. So I pray that you'd use us for that purpose, and we bless your holy name. And I want to thank you for everyone who's put in effort in preparing the meal today, and I want to thank you for this opportunity. We bless your name. We give you glory. I do ask you to bless Brother Ron's ministry at American Indian College. Bless that school. I pray that many young people or people of all ages would come through those courses and graduate and become instruments in your hands to reach their people for Jesus. Well, help us to do the same, Lord. Well, I love you and I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. We're dismissed, but come on right through here and let us enjoy. I'm going to get the chocolate fountain going.
Hi, my name is Ron Clouse. I'm with the American Indian College. I'm a U.S. missionary. I'm here at Freeport Assembly of God and just had a mission service. Just want to kind of show you the table that I have. It's a kind of representation of the specifically the American Western Indian. Some of it's Eastern. What we have here first is this is a Cherokee dance rattle. This is from the Western Cherokee tribe. It's made out of a turtle shell, a stick, some leather, and some stones. And I always tell the kids when they shake it, they have to dance. You know, so most of them like to do that. We have some pottery here. This is all Navajo pottery. You can tell that it's Navajo because on the bottom it will always have the Navajo, and then it's signed by in Navajo by the artist. We also have some. This is from the Cherokee tribe. This is just a little basket. Just something as a little thing we got in Cherokee, North Carolina. This is also this is from Cherokee. This is a tomahawk. This is really a headbanger. You don't want to get hit with this. It's a granite stone. All of this, this is a spearhead. They would put this on a stick and then use that for hunting. And this is a replica of a Navajo arrow. It's a half-size replica. And you can see that the arrow, anything that's made by Native Americans always has some form of authenticity to it. This has a little certificate on it. The pottery is always signed. I buy all my stuff on the reservations, usually at trading posts and stuff like that. But this is also a Navajo blanket that was bought in Oklahoma. Cherokee, I think. Yeah, this is Cherokee blanket was bought in Oklahoma at a trading post. And this is just kind of a representation of some of the stuff that we use, and it's part of my display. Kids like to come by. I also have here some Indian corn. Many people have never seen this. Oftentimes you see it, though, as a Halloween and Thanksgiving decoration. This would be the type of corn that is indigenous to North America. It would be the corn that the pilgrims were introduced to by the Native Americans. This is the original. All the other corn comes from this. And yes, it is real, and you can eat it. It's whatever you would use field corn for, you could use this corn for as well. And that's about all the stuff that we have here today. That just want to, if you ever wanted to check out anything about the college, you can go to aicag.edu, and they have a beautiful video in there about the college. Or you can go to my website, christforthetribes.com, all spelled out. And view the video on media. Just click on media and you can see a video about our ministry and the Native Americans. So thank you very much.